Favourite returns with a new series on BBC One now. It's Bill and Ben with 2.4 children. This is BBC Two, Thursday night at 8:30. And you know what that means.
Tonight's Top Gear, Steve Berry's at the International Motorcycle Show at the NEC in Birmingham. And on the road with the best new bikes for 96. Plus, an elderly classic car that looks like it was designed this morning.
The Jaguar XJR is a very fast car. The power from its 4-litre supercharged engine is relentless, allowing it to simply surge past slower moving traffic. The trouble is, there are people who say, yes, I want a Jaguar, but I don't want to surge past slower-moving traffic. I want to explode past it. Which is where this comes in, the Jaguar Stealth Tornado. It's a bit of a mixed jet metaphor, or a mixed jetophore, if you will. But there's nothing at all muddled about the way it goes. You can tell straight away that there's something different about this Jaguar. It has the menacing, puffed-up glower of a bouncer at a nightclub when you've just turned up wearing jeans. You may be surprised, therefore, to discover it's very quiet and very comfortable in here. But among the prime ministerial refinement, there are clues that all is not as it was. Look here, I've got Formula One style gear shift buttons on the wheel. Down here there's a button for turning the power steering off to make it more sporty. And here, a secondary traction control device. Curiouser and curiouser.
The ride is race car firm. It sits 2.5 centimetres lower than a standard Jaguar Sovereign on hand-built shock absorbers and tyres like garden rollers. The brakes, the clutch, the gearbox itself are all uprated. Somebody has designed this car to handle a simply enormous amount of power, which is a good thing, because it can do 175 miles an hour.
I mean, we are talking here about a car that's got 450 horsepower and 505 foot-pounds of torque. It's got a better power-to-weight ratio than an Aston Martin Vantage. And it feels like it. So let's have a look at what, obviously, is a very special engine. It started out in life as a plain Jag 4-litre, but then a company called Paramount Performance took it out to 4.2 litres. They put dry liners in there, new pistons, they gas-flowed the cylinder heads, but more important than all that, down there there's two intercoolers, and here there are two turbochargers. If there is a fly in the ointment, it's price. You pay £15,000 for the engine, £25,000 for the other stuff, and then £40,000 for the car. It would seem that the art of tuning has moved out from under the arches. So what about this then, the Dodge Viper? Are there really people out there who look at it and go, yes, nice car, but a bit pedestrian, a bit lacking in testosterone, a bit muesli? Well, it would seem that there are.
Now, the standard car has a 415-horsepower, 8-litre V10 engine. It's really, really quick.
Theoretically. You see, the problem was, as you approached the motorway speed limit, the buffeting got so bad that it felt like you were driving not so much a car as a weapon of mass destruction. At this speed, about 60 miles an hour, it feels like I'm having my hair cut with a strimmer.
But then Chrysler's British importers designed a removable hard roof. That eliminated the buffeting and provided a cue for the tuning companies to go to work. This is no ordinary Viper. It's called the Venom, and in a recent American road race, it did the 90-mile route at an average speed of 165. On the straight bits, it was touching 200.
The Texan tuning company that turned this from an Elton John ballad into a Guns N' Roses guitar solo didn't even resort to turbos. They just stroked the motor out to 8.5 litres, and the result is an astonishing 635 horsepower. But the power is not the most amazing thing about this car. The price is.
A similarly fast McLaren F1 is £500,000. The Ferrari F50 is £320,000. This tweaked Viper is £80,000, all in. Speed may well kill, but in this case at least, it doesn't break the bank.
I still can't believe that somebody would buy a Dodge Viper and then make it go faster. But there you have it, the ultimate tuned car. Or maybe not.
For a brief moment, the Jaguar XJ220 was the fastest car in the world. It was timed at 217 miles an hour, and all over the world, plutocrats were preparing their platinum credit cards. But then, two things happened. The recession and the McLaren F1, a car which put the 220 in the shade. Small wonder that even today, nearly 50 remain unsold. Well, now, the recession is over. McLaren is to stop making the F1, and the XJ220 has been breathed on by a dragon who had chili for supper last night. Welcome to the XJ220S. You may consider this sacrilege, but the old XJ220 was a bit of a Labrador. Yes, it was fast, but it handled and braked like a truck. Now, to create the S, the chaps at TWR Motorsport have fiddled about with the engine management system. Plus, they fitted enormous turbochargers so that it now develops a colossal 680 horsepower. Now, that was the easy bit. The hard part was taking a car that was already supposed to be as light as a souffle and reducing its weight by half a ton. So they replaced the complex drop-down headlamp covers with pieces of Perspex. The body was aluminium, is now composite. Were it not for the tyres, the 220S would just float away. And then look inside. The seats in the original model were like Wellingtons. They weighed 43 kilograms each. But in this, I got a pair of ballet shoes. Right, that's enough waffle. Let's go. This is what it's like to have your cake, eat it, and then come back for second helpings. The last time I went in something this fast, it was made by Boeing.
This is the most powerful road car in the world, a point that becomes blindingly obvious when the turbos kick in. Floor in first, the wheels spin. Floor in second, they're spinning again. 100 miles an hour, into third, they're spinning again. Now, I could hit you with the numbers, but it's probably better to just show you how fast this car goes.
It's still huge, but because it weighs so much less, it feels a damn sight more agile, and the brakes actually feel like they'll stop it. rather than simply slow it down a bit. And that is the key.
It's time, I'm afraid, to spread a little corduroy over the lycra of excitement that these cars produce. Don't buy a tuned car unless the other components, the brakes, the suspension and the clutch, have been uprated as well. Remember to check what the tuning has done to your insurance and your warranty. And third, don't expect a tuned engine to last anywhere near as long as an untuned one. So, all right, can I have my jeans back now, then?
One of the most important things you will do today is to help us with this year's Top Gear JD Power Car Satisfaction Survey. A unique chance to tell the UK which cars are best and which are worst. This year we're on the lookout for M registration cars. That's those registered between August 1994 and July 31st, 1995. Now, as usual, you have contacted us in your thousands and we've got more than enough information for most models. But there are still some gaps that need plugging. So, if you own or drive any of the following cars on this list and you'd like to tell us more about them, just ring us on 0800 99 1111. The calls won't cost you a penny and we will send you a questionnaire. And you can relax safe in the knowledge that you'll be doing your bit to make the motor car much better. And don't worry, if you miss the number, we'll be showing it again at the end of the programme. Some of the worst, the most hateful, the most hideous car designs ever have been visions of the future. I give you the Triumph TR7, the DeLorean, the wedge-shaped Austin Princess. And that's the trouble with futuristic car design. Somehow they always end up looking like hangovers from a Dan Dare comic. Of all the cars in all the world, I can only think of one that really was genuinely epochs ahead of its time, that still looks fresh after 30 years. And here it is, the NSU R080. The NSU what? The R080. Never heard of it? Well, that's hardly surprising because it was designed back in 65 when you were shambling round in your mum's Ford Anglia. Mind you, the cutting edge of automotive technology never comes cheap.
We're fortunate to have the first R080 in the country brought up, and we got hold of Harvey Smith, the well-known show jumper, to sit in the car, and he drove through the tape to open the garage. They were a beautiful car, and especially people coming to view them with the interest of buying, it was all for it. But unfortunately, when they got to know the price at about £1,900, they were rather lots of money. I mean, anything over £1,000 in 1967-68 was a very classy car.
Remember, we're talking 1967 here, when the rest of the world was out buying Morris Minors. Then along comes this amazing car with a clutch on the gear lever. It got quieter the faster you went and went round corners like it was on rails. The R080 was a complete and utter wow.
Life started well with the press voting it Car of the Year in 1968. Everybody loved its twin-rotor Wankel power plant, front-wheel drive and gorgeous wind-cheating aerodynamics. But soon things went wrong, with engines failing all over the place. Owners would pass each other holding up fingers to show how many replacements they'd had. The problem was the tips of the delicate rotors, which wore out in less than 10,000 miles. Before long, the brave new R080 was being hailed as an ocean-going dog. NSU honoured warranty claims till they bled white, but they were forced to axe the world's most futuristic car in 1976 after building just 37,000.
And here we are 30 years on, and this car looks like the designer's ink is only just dry. Look at the raised waistline, the high boot, the huge glass area, the softly tapering roof. These are all now established parts of the car designer's vernacular, but they appeared first on NSU's Prodigy.
Inside, the vast cabin has echoes of an Audi 100. The Parkinol seats could have been lifted straight out of a Mercedes S-Class, and the controls wouldn't look out of place in a modern BMW. It really was a car that could impress even the hardest-hearted cynic.
I bought
bought my first R08 quite by accident. It was a metallic blue one with alloy wheels, and it had the registration SLA 500. I think the car cost me about £1,000, and I sold the plate for £1,000, so the R08 was free. And I was so impressed by it that I kept it for, 2 years, did 30,000 miles, never a moment's problem. And I remember it as such a special, distinctive car that I always regretted getting rid of it.
My theory was to drive your R08 as fast as you could and never use it for short journeys, slogging around town. But these days, there's no longer a shadow hanging over the R08's reliability. Specialists have sorted the rotor seal problem, and as Mazda have proved with their RX-7, the rotary engine is a power plant to be proud of.
So that then is the case for the R08. Now, I know you're interested, I know you're salivating, I know your tongues are over your shoulders like scarves. So how much? It might surprise you to know that you could buy this car for 1,500 quid. It's used every day and it's reliable. And a real belter of an R08 would leave you change from £4,000, which, let's face it, doesn't even buy you a ratty MGB. And you don't need me to tell you which is the better value.
Do you like motorbikes? No? Well, tough, because we're at the NEC in Birmingham for the bike show. For a few days, these humble halls in the West Midlands are transformed into a rock and roll roller coaster of two-wheel totty. Everything's here, but for some of us, a visit to the show is about two things: girls and mad sports bikes. Like this. Who'd have thought it, eh? Triumph, a company that has traded on its glorious past, going full throttle into the future, with a bike that's going to have the Italians choking on the Tagliatelle, the T595. Aimed squarely at Ducati's 916, the T595 gets 130 brake horsepower from its three-cylinder engine and already has better advanced sales than Boyzone's Christmas single. It replaces the old Daytona 900, but is a completely new machine with an advanced fuel injection system and this distinctive polished alloy frame. There's also a slightly mad bug-eyed Street Fighter version called the T509 with a slightly less powerful engine. I haven't ridden this bike yet, but I will be very soon, and you can see that later in the series. Now, there used to be a gentleman's agreement about horsepower for sports bikes. Trouble was, the only people that took any notice of it were, rather typically, BMW. Well, there isn't an agreement anymore, because BMW have just busted it wide open with this 130 brake horsepower Leviathan. It weighs quarter of a ton, it'll cost £12,000, but it will bust 160 miles an hour with impunity. You are liking our crazy graphics, Englander? But we can't talk sports bikes without mentioning the new Honda. Honda are very bullish about the VTR1000, and justifiably so, because it's a beauty. Like a certain red Italian motorcycle beginning with D, it's got a powerful V-twin engine, in this case pushing out about 110 brake horsepower. The Firestormer is intended to take sales from Ducati's 900SS, and may even bother the mighty 916. Before you laugh, consider this. A 916 retails for £13,000 if you can get one. The Firestormer is yours for just £8,000. Can we stop now? I'm feeling a bit queasy. No, this isn't the same bike, and you can tell it's not because it says Suzuki on the side. But the TL1000 does look an awful lot like the Honda. It's got a slightly more trick suspension setup and it's a bit more sporty, but we can't tell which one rides best because we haven't ridden either of them. The price is expected to be, that's right, the same as the Honda. There's a new Leverda, a new Bimota, and a new Ducati, but I feel irresistibly drawn to this stand. Buell are new to the UK, they're an all-American company. What we have here is an antique Harley-Davidson engine and thoroughly modern sports cycle parts. Essentially, this is a two-wheel Dodge Viper. But as well as torque, the four-valve lump has potential for enough vibration to bounce your liver off your lungs. But sophisticated engine mounts keep the vibes nice and mellow. With such a monumental motor, Buell were keen to keep everything else neat and light. So the 2-in-1 exhaust is slung underneath there, along with the monoshock rear suspension. Up the front, unusually, just a single disc. But it has a 6-piston caliper with a bite like a scrapyard dog. Eric Buell was taught most of what he knows about motorcycles on the track. And what he learned was that the last thing you need on the road is a race bike. So the Buell Lightning has got smooth, snatch-free belt drive, infinitely adjustable suspension, and a seat, peg, and handlebar position designed for a human being rather than an organ grinder's monkey. The Buell Lightning is a heavy hitter, but it practices a noble art. And at £8,995 on the road, you don't need to be an aristocrat to afford one. Daftest name of the show this year is a toss-up between Yamaha's Dragstar, which you'll see in all of its overdone glory later in the show, and this bike, the Suzuki Freewind. Hey, titter ye not. This is what they're calling a town bike, and if you've never considered commuting by motorcycle, you might try one of these. It's got a nice comfy seat, a punchy and economical 650cc motor, and weather protection. Well, sort of. There are more town bikes here than you can shake a Gaxo camera at, but most are parts bin specials. One that isn't is Aprilia's Pegaso. It's 90% new for 97, and its 5-valve 650cc engine is the most powerful in its class. But there's commuting, and there's commuting. You see lots of bikes like this in town, but not so many on the open road. Because let's face it, there's no one to go up at you on the open road. The Yamaha Royal Star is an unashamed Harley copy. But it's a lot of fun, and the people that buy them couldn't care less. And Yamaha have another American-style motorcycle, not quite so grand. It's called the Dragstar, and it's a hunk of burning fun. Just look at that. A chrome caked-in air cleaner, shotgun-style pipes, spoke wheels, a proper headlight. Such a rock and roll ride could only come from... Japan? The Yamaha Dragstar is part of a disturbing new phenomenon in motorcycling, the Japanese custom bike that's really rather good. The 650cc V-twin engine pushes out about 50 horsepower via shaft drive to a righteously oversized rear tyre. But this is no ball of fire, and the limited ground clearance means that vigorous riding will be rewarded with horrible grinding noises or even a trip to casualty. But that would be missing the point. This bike is all about kicking back with your knees in the breeze, or the sleet. And it does it rather well. For £5,500, it's half the price of the Harley it so desperately wants to be. But most people will buy it because they're vertically challenged and the seat is lower than the dangly bits on a Dachshund. This is the most blatant Japanese rip-off of a custom Harley yet. Dyed-in-the-leather bikers will be ripping out their beards at such sacrilege, but everyone else, from small boys to big girls, will think it's great. And so do I, because I reckon if you're going to copy something, you might as well go the whole hog. Not a machine to get too excited about, unless you don't get out much, is Kawasaki's new ER5. It's got pleasant retro styling without being too much of a fancy Dan, and 50 horsepower from its 500cc engine. But a word of warning, because bikes like this are a portent of doom. You see, they've been built to be restricted. We've told you about this before. If you're under 21 and don't pass your test before January, you could end up stuck on one of these for 2 years in its strangulated 33 horsepower form. And no one wants that. All right, it's tiny wheels time. Hey, come on. Britpoppers like Oasis and Blur are all scooter fans, and they're cool, aren't they? Well, they're very rich anyway. So let's have some respect for the little wasp that's been buzzing about for half a century. It's hard to believe that this Italian icon is 50 years old, because it doesn't look it. The latest evolution, the ET4125, keeps the classic looks, but now it's got twist-and-go transmission and a proper disc brake up front, instead of relying on drum brakes and the power of prayer. All this for less than £2,500 on the road.
Here's another factory custom. The deeply raked forks of this all-new Suzuki are meant to evoke old custom choppers. It's got an 800cc V-twin engine, an air cleaner made out of an old army mess tin, and a big butch name, the Marauder. It'll be with us next year. Ooh, I can't wait. Actually, I can. And I'd much rather show you this, the new Suzuki GSXR 600. For many people, this will be the bike of the show, because the 600 class is affordable, accessible, and it's getting better all the time. This is as close as you'll get to a Grand Prix bike you can ride on the road, because the dimensions of Suzuki's GSXR 600 are based on those of Kevin Schwantz's RGV 500. It's got the best power-to-weight ratio in its class, and the road testers have been ecstatic. One question though, when a 600 has got 108 horsepower and retails for £7,000, why would you want a 750 for £2,000 more, particularly a Suzuki GSXR 750? You know when I said that the Suzuki 600 was the closest thing you get to a Grand Prix bike on the road? Well, I was fibbing, because this is the new Bimota, the V-Due, and it's got a 500cc V-twin two-stroke engine, just like McDoohan's. Bimota have been working on this bike for 4 years to make sure it meets the toughest emissions regulations, and it does, including California, the toughest of the lot. On sale with us from June, it'll cost between £13,000 and £14,000, and I'm in love with it. Right, that's your lot. We couldn't possibly do justice to the bike show in 10 minutes. You'll just have to come down and have a good drool yourselves. It's on till Sunday the 17th. £10 to get in, and under 10s are free. Right, I'm off now to lick that Bimota all over. I was caught in the city one day. Everybody was flashing by me like
images of tombstone. Images of tombstone. In Top Gear next week, Andy Willmans in the land of the rising sun with an exclusive road test of Mazda's latest hotshot, the RX-01. Plus, Tony Mason reads out loud from a workshop manual, The Haynes Story. And don't forget Top Gear on the wireless every Saturday on Radio 5. This week it's the new Volkswagen Passat and a beach buggy. And I'll be back on Saturday, BBC Two at 8:40, with another Cars the Star. It's the Citroën 2CV this time. Will I like it or will I loathe it?
This BBC Top Gear video includes highlights from all five rounds of the 1996 British Rally Championships. It's available now.
Rover is on a recruitment drive, and 20,000 people are keen to get behind the wheel.
I'm willing to work here 1 month without money.
Those who qualify must quickly get up to speed.
The cars are just going by and by and by.
But though they can join the line, they can't beat it. When Rover met BMW...
First 10 years is the hardest.
Tuesday at 9:30 on BBC Two.
Exploring the mysteries of the brain, neurologist Oliver Sacks travels to a remote Pacific atoll to study the highest concentration of colour blindness in the world. That's in half an hour.
If you only go to one hairdresser this week, make sure it's not Michael Bolton's.
Comedians with a sense of rhythm. Musicians with a sense of fun.
Madonna's baby was born by cesarean section. The baby apparently wanted to dodge any photographers lurking outside the normal exit.
Never mind the Buzzcocks, Tuesdays at 10 on BBC Two.
Alien activity now on BBC Two. The Solomons are getting to grips with the facts of life on Earth.
As many intelligent people...